Let me be the first to stand up and say, I love your God. Sister Brooks is standing up. And I know that many others could stand up and say, I love the Lord. Thank you very much, church choir, for that beautiful song of meditation. Thank you, youth choir, not to be undone, for that special music. Thank you, Brother Livingston. Singing lead. You know, somehow I got jealous. But you do what you do and I do what I do. Welcome, Sister Redmond. I'm just sitting here and looking at the congregation, and I gave your brothers and sisters greetings some weeks ago from you in the sunshine city of Trinidad, and you are now here in the cold. I know that you missed where you're coming from, but it is good to see you. You're back home, and we're happy that you made it safely. I just got a message just at the end of the prayer that Brother Francois just lost his sister in New York. Could you stand, please, so that the virgin can see you? And he just got the news a few minutes ago that his sister died in New York. Let us pray for him that the Lord will truly comfort the family members during this time of bereavement. The message that the Lord has laid on my heart to share with God's people comes to us from the book of Joshua. I have entitled the message, Lessons from AI. Lessons from AI. The scripture reading, Joshua, the 7th division, the 4th verse, that was read by young sister Skerrind. I'm talking with her for the second time this week. See, I spoke to them at school earlier this week at their devotion. And the message then was, satisfy with what you have. Because there are many who are not satisfied with what they have. They want more or want to be like others, but just satisfy with what you have, with what the Lord has given to you. Because when you look at others, you are far more blessed than others are. The text before us is the defeat of Israel, a rare defeat of Israel. The word of the Lord says, so about 3,000 men went there from the people, but they fled before the men of AI. And the men of AI struck down about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate of Shibarim and struck them down on the descent. Therefore the hearts of the people melted and became like water. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell to the earth on his face before the ark of the Lord until evening. both he and the elders of Israel, and they put dust on their heads. And Joshua said, "Alas, Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all? To deliver us into the hand of the Amorites, to destroy us. Oh, that we had been content and dwell on the other side of Jordan. Oh Lord, what shall I say when Israel turns its back before its enemy? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear of it and surround us and cut off your name from the earth. Then what will you do for your great name?" Lessons from AI. Let us pray. Come, sweet Holy Spirit, permeate this place right now. Touch the hearts of your people. Speak through your humble servants. Words of hope, words of consolation, words of wisdom, but words from above. May these words find lodgment in our hearts that will bring forth fruit meet for repentance. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible tells us that Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is near Beth Aven, to the east of Bethel, and told them to go up and spy out the region. So the men went up and spy out Ai. When they returned to Joshua, they said, "Not all the people will have to go up against Ai. Send 2,000 or 3,000 men to take it. And do not worry all the people, for only a few men are there in the city of Ai." Jericho was an important city situated about 5 miles west of the River Jordan and about 8 miles north of the Dead Sea, and 15 miles northeast of Jerusalem in a straight line at the foot of the Judean mountains on the highest ledge of the Jordan Valley. This city was a formidable city during the time of the conquest of the Israelites. The fall of Jericho is well known. Even children can recite it. Men were sent out from the camp east of the Jordan to spy out the land of Jericho. They were shown hospitality in the home of Rahab the harlot, who also protected them and aided their escape when they were hunted by the inhabitants of Jericho. As a reward for her help and for her faith in the God of the Israelites, the spies promised to save her life and property, a promise that was faithfully kept by the Israelites. After the Israelites crossed the Jordan, they camped at a city called Gilgal near Jericho and marched around the city once a day for 6 days. And on the seventh day, they marched around it 7 times. And then at the final shout of trumpets, the scripture says that the walls collapse and the mighty fortress of Jericho was defeated. The Israelites entered the city of Jericho, destroyed its
inhabitants except Rahab and her family. And they burned everything, saving only certain precious objects for use in the sanctuary, according to Joshua chapter 6, verses 21 through to verse 24. Joshua, after destroying the city of Jericho, pronounced a curse over it, that anyone who built that city would be cursed. Joshua chapter 6 and verse 26. Joshua and the Israelites now turn their attention, after defeating the mighty city of Jericho, they now turned their attention to a small Canaanite city by the name of Ai, located in the vicinity of Bethel, near, just on the outskirts of Jericho. The first time that Ai is mentioned in scriptures is in Genesis chapter 12 and verse 8. The Bible says that Abraham pitched his tent between Bethel and Ai. The Bible says that Joshua sent spies into the land. This is the third time that spies are sent into the land of Canaan to spy the land of Canaan. The first time spies were sent to the land of Canaan, they were sent by Moses. Joshua was young and was one of the spies who went into Canaan to spy out the land of Canaan. And the scripture tells us in Numbers chapter 13 that Joshua and the other 11 spies returned to the camp of Israel. The Bible also says that 10 spies brought evil report, while 2 spies brought back a good report. The 10 spies said that they were like grasshoppers, and that giants prevailed the land of Canaan, and that if they should go up and fight against the Canaanites would destroy them. They said the land was a good land. The land flows with milk and honey. As a matter of fact, the land was so fertile that the Bible says that a bunch of grape was supported by 2 men on a staff. The grapes from Canaan was large. But the Bible says that Caleb and Joshua quieted the people. And Caleb and Joshua said to Moses and the people of Israel, if God is for us and if God is with us, let us go up at once and possess the land of Canaan. Let us go forward. He was a young man when the first set of spies went into the land of Canaan. The second time spies were sent into the land of Canaan, they were sent by Joshua. Moses was now dead. God had raised up a new leader. And this new leader was one of the spies who went in first and came back with a good report that if the Lord is with them, then they would possess the land. He is now the leader. He organized that spies should be sent into the land of Jericho a second time. And these spies went into the land of Jericho. They spied out the land of Jericho. And they returned. They went back to the city of Jericho, destroyed the city of Jericho, and the prostitute Rahab, who hated the spies when they entered the city of Jericho. The spies promised that they would not kill Rahab and her family, but that they would spare the household of Rahab. They were true to their word. Rahab left a red rope in her window to identify where she lived. And when Joshua and the children of Israel entered Jericho and indiscriminately burn down the city and kill the inhabitants of Jericho. Rahab and her family were spared. The third time spies are sent is recorded in Joshua chapter 7. We're after destroying Jericho. Joshua once again sends spies into the city of Ai. The men who view Ai came back and presumed to instruct Joshua how to proceed against Ai. They said, listen, we don't need a great army. We just need a few men to go up into Ai and to destroy this small Canaanite city. How could these spies come to such a conclusion? One, Ai had no walls. Jericho had a massive wall around it. A matter of fact, Bible scholars said that houses were built on the walls of Jericho. It means that the city was fortified. And it was difficult for their enemies to penetrate through the walls and to get into the city. But the walls came tumbling down under the mighty power of God. And the inhabitants of Jericho, they were defeated. Ai had no walls. So they concluded that the city would be an easy take. Secondly, Ai had no army. Jericho had a huge army. A matter of fact, it is said that Jericho was the mightiest city in Canaan during the time of the conquest of the Israelites. They had soldiers who were trained for war. Ai had none. So if this city has no wall to protect them, has no trained soldiers to fight for them, it is an easy take. Thirdly, just a few people lived in Ai. The Bible tells us that the inhabitants of Ai numbered about 12,000 men. Of course, women and children were there. But only the men were numbered. About 12,000 men. Estimated the city of Ai might find themselves with approximately 36,000 people. If every man is married, that would be 24,000. And with children, about 30 plus thousand. A small city. Bible scholars believe that during the time of the conquest, the number of people in Jericho were thousands. Maybe 100,000 people lived in the city of Jericho. Jericho was defeated. Ai did not have the number of people that Jericho had. Therefore, this city would be an easy take. Fourthly, Ai was a poor city. Jericho was a very rich city. All the inhabitants and all the spoils of the city were to be destroyed. Only the silver and the gold and the vessels of the brass and iron were reserved and put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. Jericho was a rich city, and the Lord told them that when they destroyed Jericho, they must destroy everything, including their spoils and their idols. But the gold and the silver, they should keep it because it belonged to the Lord. I told you I was going to talk about money. Gold and the silver, the money in the city, the Lord says, belong to me. But everything else, you should destroy. Only the money I want. Lessons from AI. First lesson. One, write it down. Overconfidence. First lesson from the city of AI. Overconfidence. This was expressed by the spies in their report to Joshua. Recorded in Joshua chapter 7 and verse 3. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up. You see, when they went up to Jericho to fight against Jericho, all the people went up to fight against Jericho. Now the spies said to Joshua, let the people rest. Overconfidence. Let the people rest. Do not worry all the people. Because you know that a survey in the church says that it is 25% of the people who do the work in the church. The question is, what happened to the other 75% of membership? Come to church, sit in the pews, clap their hands, sing a song, enjoy a good sermon, leave the church and return next week. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let them rest. There is never a time for complacency in the house of the Lord. There's never a time to be overconfident, to believe that the others who are doing the work will get the work done. No! We need everyone on board. Every hand. And every heart in the work of the Lord, no one can sit at ease. Don't worry the people. You have to worry some of you. So that you get active for the Lord. You can't just sit down and not doing anything. You need to tell your neighbor. You need to get active for the Lord. We need to worry some of you. In 2017, we need to worry some of you. That you start singing on the choir, we need to worry some of you. So that you come out to distribute tracts, we need to worry some of you. So that you come and support the service of the services of the church and take somebody with you. We need to worry some of you. By asking you to do something in church. And you don't find excuses that you have to work. But you make the sacrifice for the Lord. Because too often we ask you to do something. And too often you are unavailable to work for the Lord. Have to worry some of you. Don't worry the people. The spies told Joshua with overconfidence. Let them sit at ease. Why? Because they are just a few people, a few men who in the city. The work is not hard. The work is not difficult. He can do it. She can do it. But the proverb says many hands make the work what? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise his name. Evidently, the spies in their self-confidence and underestimated the defenses of the city. But more than that, the Israelites, flush with victory, failed to realize that divine help alone could give them success, and neglected to take God into their counsel when planning to attack Ai. See, the job is too easy. No walls, no army, just a few people. We are rich, we have everything. We do not need God. We can do it by ourselves. If we take down this great city, this little city will never be able to stand before. We do not have to talk with God. Joshua did not even counsel with God. Sometimes out of our arrogance, we are defeated. We need to take God into counsel with everything that we do. Don't depend on the flesh, because the harm of flesh will fail you. Trust in God means success. Failure to trust in God means defeat. It was God and not their valor that gave the Canaanites' city, Jericho, into their hands. Not because Joshua led a great army. No. It was because of God. God gave them the victory. God told them to march around the city once a day. God told them to march around the city on the Sabbath 7 times. God told them to shout and to blow the trumpet. God told them. It was all about God. It had nothing to do about Joshua and his leadership. God gave them the victory. You see, overconfidence involves having a highly bloated ego. We don't need God. This is just a small city. Your ego got to them. Bloated ego. An above normal confidence in one's knowledge, what they know, their ability, what they have done. Overconfidence person will boast of his ability and dear situations or challenges in his power. Usually he will return with a tale of woe and defeat. That is when the Lord loves to show up, you know, to show that he is in charge. He's large and in charge. When we believe that we can do it on our own because we have done it before, and so we can do it again. Such was the life of Samson. Overconfidence would reduce Samson to a common prisoner. He was so confident of his anointing that he felt it did not matter whether he disclosed his secret of greatness or not. But he soon found out when he got up, the scripture says, and he was going out to do what he had done before, he discovered that he had no strength to perform it. Done it before in confidence. Got up believing that he would do it again, only to discover that he had no strength. wisest man Solomon who ever lived penned these words in the book of Proverbs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on what you know. Lean not on your own knowledge. Lean not on your own ability. In all thy way acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. God is in control. It is time for us to know that God is in control. We must let go and let God take control of our lives, and the Lord surely will deliver. Lesson number 2 from AI. Take out your pen and your pencil. Success cannot come when there is sin in the camp. Success cannot come when we are living a life of habitual sinning. So the Lord said to Joshua, get up. Why do you lie on your face? Israel has sinned. They have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have taken some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. I repeat, they have transgressed my covenant, the covenant that God made with them. Listen. Bible, here God speaking is using the plural term. The Bible didn't say he has, referring to Achan. But the Bible says they have transgressed my covenant, for they have taken some of the accursed things. Not only have they taken, but the Bible says they have stolen. And I'm going to flesh it out. It is like, will a man rob God? Yes, you have robbed me. Wherein have you robbed me? You have robbed me in tithe and offering. I'm going to prove it from the text. Where Jesus says that you have stolen. Not from the Babylonians, but you have stolen from me, and you have put it among your own stuff. Oh, the word of God is sweet. I love it. And I study the word and I try to dig it, and the Holy Spirit work in my head to bring some things to light. Ahab did not defeat Israel. And I repeat that so that you hear it loud and clear. Ai did not defeat Israel. Israel defeated themselves by disobeying God. You see, when we obey God and when we walk in his statue, the Lord will guide us and we are undefeated. When we disobey God, that is where the defeat comes. The failure at Ai signifies the power of secret sins, which robs us of fellowship with God. You see, you can't pray the way you ought to pray. Because that thing is troubling you. You can't sing the way you ought to sing because that thing is troubling you. You can't praise the Lord the way you want to praise the Lord, because it is in the back of your mind, in the middle of your head. It is troubling you, robs you of the fellowship with God. You see, I don't know, because his eyes are everywhere present. And so between you and God, that fellowship, that communion that you should have with God, you can't have it. Something is worrying you. Something is eating you out. To lose fellowship is to lose all power. And testimony. You see, you want to testify for God, but you're not sure. You're hesitant with your testimony. Something is killing you. Something is killing you. Not only is this truth brought out by Achan's individual sin, that is Achan taking the gold and the silver and the Babylonish garment. Too easy a text for me to talk about that. I will not be talking about that. Not only is this truth brought out by Achan's individual sin, but the truth of oneness of God's people suffering as a result of an individual sin. Come on now, Sister Brooks. You know where I'm going. You see, one sinner in the church can weigh down the church. Weigh down the progress and the advancement of the work of the Lord. One sinner. Because not only Achan and his family suffered, but the Israelites suffered. 36 men were killed. They were driven back in humiliation. Families of Israel suffered. The entire congregation suffered because of one man's sin. The whole camp suffered defeat of the enemy. You see, sin is individual in its act, but sometimes it is collective in its result and punishment. One man. One sin. Cause problem to the entire congregation. The whole cause of Christ is injured by the sin of one believer. Whether it is a sin of omission or the sin of commission, Achan took the things as though it belonged to him. Did not belong to him. God said, destroy the spoils. The gold and the silver is mine. You take that, because I have a work for you to do with the gold and the silver. When I establish my kingdom permanently in the Canaanite city, then you will take out those silver and those gold, and you're going to use them in the worship of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You see, the silver and the gold was to be used for God's purpose. The money, get rid of the accursed things, but the money I need. We need money to do ministry. We need money to do God's work. God said, I need the money because you're going to erect a sanctuary in the land in which you go, and you're going to use the gold and the silver to spread the name of the Lord throughout the earth. I need the money. And Achan stole the money that belonged to the Lord. Belonged to the Lord. Some of the stolen things God ordered destroyed. Others, the gold and the silver had been dedicated to the Lord. He put his stamp upon it. He told Joshua, it belongs to me. It is dedicated to me. It is blessed. When you go there, destroy everything else. But the money I want, mine. Don't play around with it. Don't touch it. Mine. The scripture says that he stole it when he was searched out and discovered. Not only was Achan stoned to death, but the scripture tells us that his entire family. Lord, clean the house to stem corruption. He did it at the beginning of the early church when Ananias and Sapphira tried to lie against the Holy Spirit. And Peter said, you have not lied against me, but you have lied against the Holy Spirit. And Ananias fell dead instantaneously. And they took him out. And his wife came with the same lie. And he said, the feet of those who bury your husband, they are waiting to do likewise. And she too died immediately and was buried. And that was done to stem corruption in the early church because of the sins of Ananias and Sapphira. They are Achan in the camp today. I repeat it. They are Achan in the camp today. Of the tithes and the offering. It is declared, will a man rob God? Yet he had robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed you? In tithes and in offering. The tithe is consecrated to the Lord and is to be put in the treasury. There are those who take as though it belonged to them and to put it among their stuff. Bible says, and Achan took the money, the gold and the silver. The Bible says that it was found among where? His stuff. Stuff here is what we use it to do other than. We use it to do our own business, our own pleasure. Other than. Placing it where it ought to go, in the treasury of the Lord. Told Joshua that it belonged to me. Destroy the Babylonian gods, destroy the spoils. But the silver and the gold, the money is dedicated to me for the advancement of. There are those who take as though it belonged to them and put it among their stuff. They are a curse, the scripture says. They are devoted. And that is what the Hebrew word translate meaning. You know. A curse means marked for destruction. Or devoted to destruction from the original language. And so because Achan took it, and Achan now become a curse. He was marked, devoted for destruction. The cure was such that those who took up the thing devoted to destruction themselves thereby become devoted to destruction. That which should have been destroyed, you take it unto yourself, so you are destroyed. Curse, the Bible says. And that is what will eventually happen to sin in the last days. Because sin is found in anyone who will be lost. They will be destroyed because sin will be eradicated from this earth. The third and final lesson from the city of AI for us today is simply this. When sin is confessed, God takes man's failure and turns them into blessing. You see, when wrongs are made right, God transformed that curse into blessing. You remember that the sons of Levi, they were cursed by Jacob for what they did. But the Bible says at the foot of Mount Sinai, when Moses returned from the mountain after communing with God for 40 days and 40 nights, when he returned with the Ark of the Covenant, he found them committing war down at the foot of the mountain. After they had just received the Ten Commandments orally. And the scripture says Moses cast down the Ten Commandments written on two tables of stones. They were broken. Over 32,000 perish in their sinfulness at the foot of the mountain. And when Moses asks the question, who is on the Lord's side? The scripture says that the tribe of Levi stood out on the Lord's side. And their curse from their father was reversed because it seems as if they would have confessed their sins into a blessing. Lord instructed Moses that the tribe of Levi would officiate in the sanctuary service of the Lord. Only the tribe of Levi, their curse turned into a blessing. When sin is confessed, when we make our wrongs right and our crooked path straight with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, man's failures, they are turned into blessing. It's simple. From our text, passage of scripture illustrates that there is a time to pray, but not until confession of sin is made. I repeat it. There is a time to pray, but not until confession of sin is made. Joshua knelt down, prayed. And the Lord said, listen, there is a time for prayer, but when you are praying now, it's not a time for prayer. Not a time for prayer. It is a time for action. You see, sin must be confessed. Persons must turn away from that which is wrong so that I can bless them. Get up, find a sinner, let them confess, remove the accursed thing from the camp. Then I can show my face once again in the camp of Israel. And the Lord said to Joshua, do not be afraid nor be dismayed. Take all the people of war and with you, and arise and go up to the city of Ai. Joshua found the sinner. The sinner was destroyed along with his family. And the message came that after sin is confessed, your failures, the defeat that they got, was just a temporal setback for God's big setup. After they confess their sins and the griefs, I'm telling you, the Lord said to Joshua, you're going to do it again. You're going back up to Ai. And this time around, because you have talked with me, You have asked me about the plans and how to defeat this small city, even though you considered this city to be an insignificant small city. You need to talk with me and let me tell you how to conquer such a city. They didn't know. Get up. Rise and go up to Ai. See, I have given into your hand the king of Ai. I have given you his people, I have given you his city, and I have given you his land. So it was that all who fell that day, both men and women, were 12,000, and all the people of Ai. For Joshua did not draw back his hand with which he stretched out the spear until he utterly destroyed all the inhabitants of Ai, only the livestock and the spoil of the city Israel took as booty for themselves. But the gold and the silver of the city went into the treasury of the Lord. This time around, Lord said, listen, I am going to bless you so much that all the livestock and all the food and all the spoils that you will get from this defeat, it will be sweet in your mouth because it will be for you. Wait on the Lord until he gives you what he has to give to you. Run before him. Wait on the Lord. I say, he who waits upon the Lord, he will renew your strength. You will mount up like wings of eagle. You will run and not be tired. You will run and never faint. Wait, I say, upon the Lord. Just wait. Wait on the Lord. They waited and they got up. Because when they confessed their sins, God turned their failures into blessings. You know how they defeated Ai? It is recorded in the 8th chapter of the book of Joshua. You see, Joshua sent some men up to lay in ambush of the inhabitants of Ai. And so they were in ambush. And then he sent a second set of men to bait them. God gave him the plan. And so he baited the inhabitants of Ai. And when they saw them, because they had earlier defeated them, they came out after them and they chased them and they ran away. But the ambush was close to the city's entrance. And of course, when they chased the men of Israel, the men of Israel turned around on them. This time around, everybody went. Both men and women and children into this battle, because the battle was not for Joshua, the battle was for the Lord. And when the Lord fights his battle for you, you must be a winner. Amen. Amen. Pursue them, Brother Sam. And when they reach a certain journey, the men of Israel turn around to face their enemies. And when their enemies realized that the men were about to fight back and they head towards the city, men were coming from their city who were Israelites. So they were caught in between. The Bible says that the Lord destroyed them because they were promised a defeat by the Israelites. Two things about God's forgiveness: when we confess our sins and he turns our failures into victories. We must know that when we confess our sins, and he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You see, God's forgiveness teaches us about his grace. God's grace is unmerited favor. You see, what Israel did, God should have turned his back on them. But because of grace, he gave them another chance. God
God's forgiveness teaches us humility. God humbled them. They had too much pride. They were overconfident. We can take the city, we don't need God. God had to bring them back to earth so they realize that He is in control. And God's forgiveness restores joy. You see, they were sad after the defeat. But after the victory, Elder Denison, they were happy. Joy is restored. The last thing, God's forgiveness eventually will save us. God bless you.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song.
Praising.
Praising my Savior.
Dear Jesus, nobody knows the story between you and I. And when I sing my songs, O Lord, nobody knows those songs which comes from my heart, what it means to me and to you. This is truly my story. This is my song. Oh, bless your people now, we pray, and keep us safe is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Please be seated until ushered out.